So Matthew 23, I want you to see something really quickly as we move forward. The Bible says, woe unto you scribes and Pharisees, says they're hypocrites, for ye pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have omitted the weightier matters of the law. Judgment. Now these are the weightier matters, church. Judgment, mercy, and faith. Lord, that's good right there.
Amen.
And I'm reading it to you because I don't want anybody to think that I made this up. And I'll say that again. The weightier matters, the things are that God is more concerned about. Watch this, is judgment. So that's got to come. Mercy, thank you, Lord, because a lot of times we're short on that. And then also faith. Now watch what he says here. This blesses me. These ought ye to have done and not to leave the other undone. So if he was saying that when I come, I don't want you to pay tithes, why would he then come back and say, listen, that was good that y'all were doing that, but that's not the more important. That's not the heaviest. The heaviest is judgment, mercy, and faith. But he says, even when you get that, don't leave the others undone. Everybody got that? I see Jesus, in other words, enforcing tithing. I want to share with you another scripture. This is good. There's a few more, but I think the one that did it for Pastor Smith, and sometimes in my quiet time with the Lord, I'm just emotional, because it's just a constant reminder of how good he is to us. Yeah. So I could take you other places, but let's look at Hebrews chapter 7, because I think what causes people to take the position that they do is that they think that tithing was under the law. And I think what's interesting about law is that the question is always, what law are we talking about? And then the other thing we should ask ourselves is, especially as it relates to Abraham, now I thought that law came when Moses came about. God lets us know that there are some things from a relationship standpoint that he gave to Abraham prior to there even being a church, quote unquote. And as I shared with someone else, he said, why do you refer to yourself as a Hebrew Pentecostal? And I said, well, quite honestly, in the book of Genesis, God, the first person that God referred to as a Hebrew was Abraham. And it simply meant one who has crossed over. Whether we want to admit it or not, yes, our spiritual father, he was a pagan worshiper. Thought I was talking to a church that knew history.
Yeah.
Those of us who, I was born a Jew. I think you would want to check some records. I love my brothers and sisters. I just don't want you to beat up on me because I don't necessarily trace my lineage back to anybody but Jesus the Christ, Yeshua the Messiah. And I, even if you say he's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and he is, you must also accept the fact that Abraham wasn't born a Jew. As we look at this, watch this. And I really want to read all of it today because it's good. I will say this much, and if I need to read it, then I'll take my time and read it. In reading this scripture here, what the writer does is cause us to appreciate, Sister Shane, that even in Abraham's time, Sister Gail, Melchizedek, who I believe was a type of Christ in the Old Testament, because as Hebrews chapter 7, Sister Nikki tells us, he doesn't have a mother, he doesn't have a father, and there's some other things, description-wise, Shamika, that separate him from any other man I've ever met in my life. So Abraham goes to battle or to war, and I believe he comes back, and when he does, he's so grateful for what the Lord has done. It's amazing. As a believer, he says, I got to bless God. And even before there is a priesthood like that of the Levitical priesthood, God gives us a typology. He gives us someone called Melchizedek. And Abraham pays tithes to him. Now watch this. Abraham at that time is smart enough to understand, Lord, there's someone greater than me, and I need to bless him because I just got blessed. It was Abraham's way of saying, let me sow seed into Melchizedek's ministry. So Hebrews 7, and I'm just paraphrasing, but it's trust pastor today. I don't ask you to do that often, but trust me today. It's in there. When you read in Hebrews chapter 7 a little bit further, while at the same time he's building up Melchizedek, then he says, you know, but if and he starts to talk about the Levitical priesthood, came after Aaron and all of them. He says, you know, that was really all that good. And it was good for its time, don't get me wrong. He says, now we got another priest. Let me slow down. This is so good. I just need to jump a minute. I said Hebrews 7, but listen, we have, here's what makes where we are in Christ today so beautiful. We have a high priest for which Deacon, he can identify elder with everything we can go through. I was sharing Pastor Embry with someone and said, I thank God for allowing me to fall in love with him and to fall in love with his people, because when you fall in love with someone, you seek and you strive to understand.
Amen.
I was sharing with someone and said, you know, what makes me and First Lady's relationship so awesome after 25 years is that it wasn't perfect, but we continue to strive to understand each other. And you get to a place where you are able to make good decisions about battles that you're going to pick and choose. You get to a place where, for me, as an example, it might drive my wife crazy that I might leave my pajamas on the floor. But once we started living together, we didn't live together prior to being married. Let me be clear about that. Once we got married, she recognized that there were things about Mike I might not particularly care for. But they're not deal breakers. And there are things about First Lady that it drives me up a wall, but they're not deal breakers. That's why the Bible says, husbands, dwell with your wives according to knowledge. See, when you get to know someone and to understand someone, then you don't have a problem walking with that someone or being connected to them. And so because God knows that, then he gives us Jesus. A high priest who is in touch with all of our feelings, all of our emotions, anything that you could ever experience, Jesus Christ has experienced. And having said that, the same way Abraham felt, I need to bless Melchizedek. For us in this dispensation, in this time, I would think it robbery not to want to sow seed into Jesus' ministry. Not to support the, I mean, from a natural standpoint, the King of Kings and the, that's why Hebrews 7 is written, to let us know, man, if he could do, and listen, I didn't talk about this, I just came back to my memory. The fact that, watch that, Levi paid tithes, which means there are blessings that my grandchildren are going to have, my great-grandchildren are going to have, they're not even here because Michael paid tithes to Jesus. So is tithing there in the New Testament by God? Yes. And here's the other beautiful thing I want you to always remember when you're reading the New Testament. These people that we're reading about were busy living the Old Testament. Because that's all that was written during their time. That's all. God, help me. It's not as if something new came about. I don't know about you. Each time I get an opportunity to give, I'm thinking, man, I get evangelists to support the ministry of Jesus Christ. There's more, but I think that answers your question. For those who wanted me to jump and scream and holler last week, wasn't time. I had so much other stuff I had to do. I didn't forget her. I'm going to talk about it at the appropriate time. Some other things that we got time, Shane. Sense of me wearing myself out, Minister Tracy. Some mistakes that young preachers make. Get behind the microphone and try to preach every message God's given to them. Chris, they'll come back next week. Praise the Lord. Go with me to the book of John. John chapter 14. Share with you a few things. Scriptures. How many are just blessed by God? The mere fact that he would find it necessary to bless us the way he blessed us today. Mm-hmm. I don't know how. I'm not judging anybody, but I don't know how people can be here and sit still. That's just me. I mean, sometimes, you know, Pastor included, some Saturdays we're trying to be cool. You can put your hands in your pocket, but I found out he'll touch you if you put your hands in your pocket. You know, I found that he particularly don't care about clothing. You have your best set of shoes. You can't restrict the Holy Spirit. I love about him, he's such a gentleman, too. I didn't see me. I saw a lady, someone on Facebook, one of our saints, showed me a video of a lady who, she said she was in the spirit. She ran up the aisle and didn't come back down the aisle. She lost her balance and fell out. And those type of things happen, but what really was of particular interest to me was that she went to court. And she was suing the church because she felt like when they realized that she was that far in the Holy Ghost, somebody should have been there to catch her. I said, wow. Something. So when your pastor shares with the congregation things like before you go lay hands on somebody, please ask them for permission.
Yeah.
I know a lot of times you don't think pastor knows what he's talking about, but there's so many things I've experienced because of y'all. And all I do is ask you, praise the Lord. You know, if you really are being used by the Holy Spirit, then you'll be submitted to pastor. You'll come, and I've had people do this. You'll come and say, Pastor, can I pray with such and such? I'll let you know. Praise the Lord. And most of you know I'm liberal enough where it's extremely rare I'm going to tell you no, but you also need to know if I tell you no, there's a reason behind it. Because, you know, the God that we serve, he's a God of order. Whether we want to admit it or not, he's a God of structure. And also, here's another thing, he's a God of hierarchy. That's why he gives us positions in the church. But his response, our responsibility, I think somebody was praying about it this morning. I think it was Evangelist Diane. God can, I believe he uses us, me, Pastor Veronica, and the list goes on, because he can trust us not to take the authority that he's given to us and abuse his people. God never gives anybody power or authority to abuse his people. That's never the case. John 14, y'all ready? This is good. We have been given authority by God to do what we do, and we're going to do it with love. John chapter 14, as I was meditating, this thing arrested me, I'm telling you. And today's sermon, those that are streaming with us, is entitled The Power of Attorney. The Power of Attorney. John chapter 12, chapter 14, excuse me, verse 12 says, verily, how many of y'all, Lord, have mercy, and I want this to be quick, 115, how many of y'all know that we've been authorized by God to do what we do? I wish I had some believers. I wish I had people that believe the word of God. Every time I read it, Raquel, it pumps me up. I had the distinct privilege to spend some extra time with my adjutant over his house, his wife and sister and mom. We just had a lovely time. And they made a mistake. His wife made a mistake of pulling out a game. I'm not going to tell you all about it because I want us to play it here. That just got my blood flowing. There were all types of categories that you could play, Nikita, but when they came up with Bible, and Raquel wouldn't stop laughing at me. I just came alive. Just one word. Just Amen. Had me and Minister Tracy up in Deacon Johnny's face. Just one word. That's truly how past is with the word of God. I come alive, man. When you talk about sports and all that kind of stuff, I'll be like, whatever. When you talk about the word, this is, man. So when you hear pastor talk, and I have to say this blesses me. My children, as they get older, they share different things with me that's just powerful. Sometimes I'm just emotional about it. My daughter, she says, Dad, I like to hear you speak. You know, she says, and when you start to yell, she's like, is Jesus? She said, I think God is talking when you're yelling. I don't know that I always want that to be the case. But that's the best way pastor can get it out, you know. Bless the Lord. So I'm trying to be cool about it today. Is that all right? Because I know she's watching. I'm going to tell you what Michael said. Praise the Lord. John 14, as I look at this, Jesus is talking. And I want our church to be the type of church that we are to continue to be. I love the anointing on our assistant pastor. Yes. I say that, that's an anointed woman. You hear me? I thank God. Sometimes I just sit and I'm just amazed at God. Not her, but God. I just love her ability. I read a post just yesterday. No, I think it was this morning. 4 years ago, a young lady was going out to celebrate her birthday, was at the youth conference, and she was sharing how she said she enjoyed the word Friday night, she enjoyed the Sabbath day, and she said, evangelist envy prayed down heaven on earth. Amen. She said, now this is 4 years later, she said, I'll never forget that service. Amen. And it's, my point is, it's beautiful to impact a person's life to that degree. Amen. I'm just using pastor because she officiated today. Wasn't even scheduled. She came in, I think the last week was my week. She said, bitch, my God, sit down. I'll take care of it. I said, so she's been on the road, you know, last 2 weeks traveling. I know she's tired. She said, I got it. I'm so glad she took it. Let me get into this thing. So when I look at this, here's why I mentioned that. I want our church to always be a church where the gifts of the Spirit flow. And I think we can do it in an organized way or an orderly way. But I want the Holy Spirit to be able to flow, because whether you know it or not, church, we need that spiritual release in God. And I don't want us to tighten up and shrivel up. I want to share with you what the appropriate response is. As the Holy Spirit is moving, you want to come closer to God. And when I say that, I shared it last week. I was so grateful to evangelists and those who were here for prayer. But let's try to get here at 10 as best we can to give God that 1 hour of prayer. Here's the other thing. When the Holy Spirit is moving like that, let's come to the altar. I saw Mama Miguel do it, but all of us should be there. All of us, listen, I have not met anybody who could not contain any more of Christ. So I'm giving you an invitation. Let us all come to the altar and just spend time with the Lord. Amen. It's beautiful because the Lord doesn't show up, contrary to what I used to think. God does not show up just to make us feel good. It's not for us to feel relieved today and then go back out and pick back up what we left off. No, it is a life-changing experience. Amen. 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 So thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Looking at this, and having said that, I am convinced, Sister Geneva, that we are empowered by the Holy Spirit. And I'm convinced, Sister Diane, that he does it, Brother Smith, because he wants to get the glory out of our lives. I forget Deacon Johnny, Sister Nikita were singing, I think about William McDowell, I give you all of me. And I just stopped. This is just pastor. I'm not judging anybody. There are times when those songs arrest me, and I got to stop. Because I don't want to lie to the Lord. I'm saying, God, I want to do this, praise the Lord. But that's not a part of the song. It says, I give you all of me. You know, I'm thinking, Lord, I want to. Okay, some of y'all have arrived. Okay, pray for pastor. Pray, but I'm still growing. I'm saying, God, I want to do that. There's another lady. If you haven't heard it, I shout it to the praise and worship team. I think it's her name is K-C-C-A-S-E-Y-J. And the type of the song, the name of the song is I'm Yours. And it blesses me. Check it out. You know, your words, my thoughts, I think it is. Your thoughts, my heart. I passed the message. Y'all know I butcher up a song. But it ministers to me. And don't anybody text me either. I know what the words are. Praise God. I've listened to the song. But it blesses me. Blesses me. And I pray it will bless you. Because it's what our God wants from us. He wants to use us. So watch this. Verse 12 says, verily, verily. So if he's saying, listen, listen. Do you think he's got something he wants us to listen to? Amen. He says, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, ooh, Lord, the works that I do shall he do also. Amen. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Yeah. Verses 13 to 14. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Yeah. Verse 14. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. Amen. Now, either he is God or he's not. Either he meant what he said, or it was just a suggestion or a recommendation to the church. I believe that when God speaks, everything that he says comes to pass. There is no shortage in God. There is no deficit in God. There is no failure in God. So if I fail to see the power of God, it's not God. I gotta check. So he says, listen, Jesus says, listen, listen, listen. Yes, God, yes, God. He says, I'm saying unto you. That's what I like about it. My children do that to me every now and then. They've stopped. It's been some time. But Michaela would ask for something.
And I would say, yeah, go ahead and get it. She, and then she turned around and said, I'll never forget why she would do this to me. She would say, but mommy said, and I would say, what did I say?
Come on, come on,
Miss. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Yes,
sir. Amen. I mean, before I know it, I went off on a tangent, and I shouldn't have. Your mother's not my mother. I'm the... Elder Jason was teaching, doing tithing testament, tithing session, and I was thinking to myself, yeah, that's the way how it's supposed to be run. Jesus says, watch this. He's saying this because there are things that these people have heard, might I add, from some unauthorized lips. But what he's getting ready to share with us is he's saying, I trump all of them. So don't let anybody back you into a corner and tell you don't have power or you have not been given authority. Yes, you have as a believer.
Amen.
He says, he that believeth on me. How many of y'all believe on the Lord? And I mean, I'm talking about you trust God. He said, he that believeth on me, he said, the works. Listen, Shane. We have been employed by God.
Amen.
You know what? You know, it's funny, y'all. We got people here worrying about a company. You've been employed by God. God does not need you. Oh, God, please help me. I just want to share this with you. I know the word, but I just want to share. You don't need a job in order to have income. Well, what you need is to be connected to God. Now, I believe you need to work, but don't get me wrong. But if there are seasons in our life, Lord have mercy, that God will take you through only to prove something to you, only to try you. And in his doing that, it's his will to let you know, I don't need anybody. I'm not restricted by all the things that you are restricted by. So if God wants to, he can do whatever he wants to do. Let me give you an example. Today's date is what? All right. Normally around this time, it's freezing cold. Normally around this time, the grass is not green, praise the Lord, it's gray, brown, whatever the case may be. You know why? Because things are dying out. Am I right about it? So I went out this morning, I was doing some exercise and whatnot, and I came back in the house after that, and I was getting in the car, I backed the truck out of the garage, and I walked to the side of the house for whatever reason, I can't remember why, and something caught my eye, it was something yellow that I saw, and I said, what in the world was that? And I went back and looked at it, and it was a little small rose budding on the side of my house. I said, in December?
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Wait, I'm finished. So because I was, I'm embarrassed to tell you this, but because I was driving, I only texted a little bit of it, put it on Facebook real quick. I said, this is amazing. I said, this is December in Maryland. A rose is budding. And then I put global warming. And the Holy Spirit said, and I ain't show you that because of global warming. He said, I'll show you that because I want you to know as a believer that you're not limited by a season. It could be summer, it could be winter, it could be spring, it could be fall, but I told you before, but before a believer is, God will cause stuff to start growing in your life. It's the wrong season for everybody else, the wrong time for everybody, but it's your season. And I'm like Pastor Ron, how many of y'all want to celebrate God before it manifests? He showed me that rose to let you know, Michael, I haven't forgot about you. Lord, have mercy. Oh, glory to God. I'm trying to keep it together. God is not limited based upon somebody's opinion, somebody else's thought. He will move when he's ready to move. It's the evidence that he can do it. You could be in the wilderness. God allows springs to spring up all over the place. He said, the works that I do. He said here, shall he do. Let me read that again, because I don't think some of us got that. He that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do.
Amen.
You know what, church?
Amen.
I'm asking God to restore us. Because we got this church thing down real good. But it ain't church that God is after.
Amen.
God looking for people. I told you before that Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Oh, Lord, it definitely Saturday. But Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, he looking for people that have relationship with him. And then, listen, I'm at a point now, I was sharing with the deacon. One of the deacons from another church was at my house doing some work. And I said, brother, I just want to tell you my testimony where God brought me from. There was a time in which you and I couldn't even talk to each other. because I was just arrogant. Just thought you knew this and knew that. And that I said, the Holy Spirit arrested me and caused me to know God got something for everybody to do. If we're the body of Christ, I would not want my eye to act like my foot. I wouldn't want my foot to act like my mouth. I wouldn't want my mouth to act like my hand, because we all have a job to do. I don't think the church is getting it. Uh-oh, so that let me know, it's revelation for Smith. That let me know that stuff that you do, God might not have called the next person to do it.
Amen.
Just like stuff they do, he might not have called you to do. You might even be blessed by it, but if God didn't call you to that, you better keep your behind where God called you.
Amen.
We got work to do. But that lets me know. Nobody should be sitting on the bench or sitting on the seat to do nothing.
Amen.
That lets me know there should be some fire. There should be some excitement about you. I'm talking about what the Lord did for you. And you should, there should be some passion there, because Jesus had passion in his ministry. People would come from all over Brandy wanting to see him and wanting to hear what he had to say. And watch this, Aaron. They came with an expectation, because they knew if I could just get to the service, and if I could just get in the midst of that guy, my life was going to be changed. Is there anybody else out there who's experienced that? Not just going to church, but you have messed around. See, because your conversion process can happen at work. It can happen in your car. It can happen in a closet. It can happen while you're walking down the street. It can happen while you're in a dining hall. It can happen anywhere.
What
work shall I do? He said, the works that I do, he says, shall he do also. Somebody say, in greater. Somebody say, many more. Somebody say, multiplied.
Multiply.
We got work to do. We got work to do. Pastor, I got excited, to be quite honest with you, when I saw that lady come in from off the street. I saw the other gentleman come in from off the street. And I, like you, I was saying, we got to be doing something right. There was a time in my life, Elder Harris, they used to make me mad. It only made me mad because Quentin, I didn't want to take the time to work with them souls at the altar. Do you know there are days when you don't want to smell nothing? Y'all not talking to me. There are days when you don't want to deal with unclean stuff. Please, come on, church. And it never fails. It never fails. The day for which you think you're going to relax, then God send somebody. He said, now pray with him. Lord, can I pray from over here? He said, no, I want you to go over there. Pray with him. I want you to lay hands on him. Oh, y'all not talking to the pastor. I'm going to go a little bit further. And not only do I want you to lay hands on them, I don't want you to use sanitizer until they leave the service. Because we don't want anybody to be offended. Y'all not talking to nobody with your cute selves. That's why we really can't get to where God wants us to get to. Because let me tell you something. In the spirit realm, that where we got today, that was just the precursor for where God desires to take us. But he needs people who are willing. He needs people who truly have emptied out. He wants people who don't care about anything but God. So I was telling the deacon when he came to my house, I said, brother, I said, listen. I'm at a point now where I don't care what I drive. I don't care what I live in. I just want God. If I can wake up every day and I got God on the inside, I'm all right. Sort of like what Paul meant, Aaron, when he says, I've learned whatever state that I'm in to be content.
Amen.
As you know, you can say that after you've been in the, got to a place in your life in the sorority where you've had a whole lot. But if you're like Pastor Spinoza, I was walking this morning, think about this, Shemika, I said, God, you blessed us tremendously. But it's so funny how, you know, I still watch this. Mr. Tracy gives me all the time. Whenever we talk to each other, Bishop, what are you doing? And I'm always usually doing something. If I'm not trying to fix something, you know, listen, this day, I think, you know, it was the day before that. Everybody else is off chilling and whatnot. And, I just have to be doing something. And so I got up and I just redid my dryer line, you know, to the outside and whatnot. I'm at a store, I'm just feeling good about everything. She was like, Bishop, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm at work, you know, I'm doing what I got. She said, sit down. Is there anybody else like Pastor that can't help yourself?
Amen.
Like clockwork, 4:30 in the morning, my eyes come open, I thank God, I have prayer and all that kind of stuff, and then I want to see what I can get into. You can judge me, praise the Lord, I ask you pray for me, but that's me, I gotta be doing stuff. My mother used to say to me, she said, well, you're so tired, you don't even know you're tired. I said, Mom, I'm fine. She said, I can see it in your eyes, I'm fine. Sit me down on the couch, turn the TV on, and in 5 minutes, I'm gone. She said, you tired? Don't know you're tired. She said, that don't make sense. But I knew, now I know what she's talking about. But God, it's just like he made me. Jesus Christ puts passion within us where you want to go hard and you want to see people delivered. Come on, somebody. You want to see, the church is the place where people, Nikki, ought to be able to come and get delivered from whatever. And it's not for you to feel embarrassed about anything. If there's a need, you ought to be able to come to God's house.
Amen.
Is anybody else whose heart was pricked when the Lord, through our sister Pastor, was sharing with us
Many times we do come in and we just sit down. Sometimes you're just honestly tired or whatever the case may be. But you have to check yourself and say, but wait a minute, I'm not at Nikki's house. I'm not at Tia's house. Lord, I'm not at Nikita's house. I'm not at Alex's house. We're in the house of the Lord. He says, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do. Greater works than these shall he do. Wow. Thank you, Lord. Why did he say that? Because when he was in his earth suit, pretty much ministered where he was. Listen, Pastor, he chose to be restricted. Now get this. If he's just in Jerusalem and Samaria and Judea, places like that, think about this. When he dies, he transfers power to us. We're all over the world. And here's the thing I want the church to understand today. We can do something that our Messiah didn't do. You know what that is? Other than the thief on the cross, and he had major encounters with people, how many people did Jesus lead to salvation? And I'm talking specifically about Romans chapter 10. You know what he did? He left, and to me, that's the greatest gift we can give to anybody. For us to be able to share with them that you don't have to live your life like this. Accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. I know some of you thought we were heading. We're going to get there. Heading in terms of laying hands on people, being sick, being delivered, and you know, blind, being able to see, and all that kind of stuff. That's good, too. But how many of us have shared our faith with someone else? Say, can I tell you what really made the difference in my life? A man called Jesus. A man who chose to go to Calvary, who chose to empty himself out for me, who chose to identify with me. That's what I did when I dated first. I wanted to go meet her family. I wanted to spend time with her because I wanted to understand her. I wanted to know her. Amen. And think about that. God says, I love you so much until I want to come from heaven so I can get to know Dee Dee. I can get to know John. Did you ever think about that? There's not an ailment that anybody could have that Jesus Christ can't come in to, that he doesn't understand or know about. Not one thing. Who wouldn't want to come to see a man like that and come to know about a man like that? He says here, anybody enjoying the word?
Amen.
And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto the Father. And so here's the transfer. This is what blesses me. When you study power of attorney gives people authority. And more than anything, it gives them authority, elder, to do things that you would do had you been there. But Minister Tracy, you can't be there, so you leave yourself, or you leave a visible representation of you. It would be the equivalent of me taking a trip. In a few weeks, I'll be flying out to Texas to preach, and it would be me saying, well, but I'm going to give Michael Jr. all the authority to act on my behalf.
Amen.
Having said that, Michael can write checks in my name.
Amen.
He can make decisions about my health. In my name. He can make decisions about all the properties we own. In my name. Think about that. And God says, watch this. I love y'all so much until I'm going to transfer that power.
Amen.
We're not getting it. We are not getting it. I'm going to run it down just for you a minute again. He says, I'm giving you in that power of attorney the ability to make financial decisions. You can make healthcare decisions. Church isn't getting this one. That's the one I really want to stop and meddle with. When I say we make healthcare decisions, there's some of you who are dealing with stuff in here that Jesus can regulate. You would just rather pay a copay. I'm going to do this, and I hope nobody gets excited. Praise the Lord. As it does work out, praise the Lord, but I'm going to try to, I ain't trying to be any long, praise the Lord, but it's hot, praise the Lord. Give me a few more minutes. Somebody say, elevate my mind. Stay right there, praise the Lord. Make healthcare decisions. Now, do we understand what that means?
Yes.
Watch this. And usually you have to get consent, but with God, oh, come on, church. I just want the church to understand this. So we can see, if I give you the understanding as your spiritual father, then hopefully you'll be released to walk in this bad boy. The very first thing you want to do whenever you get a prognosis from a doctor is pray.
Amen.
I hear what they're saying, but we're going to see what God has to say about the matter. Amen. Listen. Oh, God.
He gave this to us. When I look around this church is filled with all types of miracles, all types of people who have been, I mean, who have gone through some stuff, and they're still sitting here.
Amen.
Like this. I know it's not by chance. Out of all the weekends that Sister Selwyn could come and be here, and she showed up today, oh, God got something in store for her. Yeah. Listen, even as she's sitting there, she will never, I declare this, Lord, I decree it in the name of Jesus, she'll never be the same again.
Yeah.
Let me ask you what I asked you last week. Is there anything too hard for God? Y'all sound like you're scared on this side. Is there anything too hard for God?
The healer is here.
Good God.
Yes, Lord.
The healer is here.
Lord, have mercy. My wife had to remind me because of the gift on my life. She was listening. We were talking about Sister Aaron's brother and what God did for him. She said, honey, you don't remember, she gave me the exact same date and played the video back for me. So, you know, I think I was preaching and was sharing with you. I said, God is reducing time. God is reducing sentences. And there were some other things that the Lord used us to say. But it takes some time, Lord have mercy. Watch this. The word comes right now, but the manifestation, it just takes a little time to catch up with what God said. And I'm telling you, I sense healing. God, hallelujah. Lord, have mercy. Woo! And God is so powerful, he don't even have to lay hands on nobody. You can be just like that centurion soldier. God, if you just speak the word, cook God from Zion, that word can go up 295, 395, 495, I-95. Come on, somebody. No matter where you are, the word can find you right where you are. That's what Jesus would do. He said, I said this, cook God from Zion. I was out getting it in this morning. I don't know how many miles I did. And the Lord started dealing with me concerning generational curses.
Oh, yeah.
But they're being broken today.
Yeah.
Here's how I know. Here's how you're going to know. I don't know that God's going to leave me to do this today. I was telling one of the ministers I was talking to. And there are days for which I can get up and I can shake it, Elder. And then there are other days, Elder, I can't shake it. And it'll be stuff. God will just tell me stuff. This chair will be different things. And I'll be trying to function like normal. But Pastor, some days, I know you know as a prophet. Some days you just can't function like normal. So I'm extra sensitive some days. Some days, I don't have time to tell you all of it. But I'll just tell you this much. Sometimes like I'll know when I'm dealing with a liar. And they don't even be lying to me at that particular time. Praise the Lord. I just know. I mean, it's just all right. Best way I can tell you is I can feel it.
Yeah.
And they'll be talking, and the Holy Spirit said, they're lying.
Yeah.
Now, earlier on, for those of you who kind of want a ministry like that, earlier on, I used to speak at the wrong time because I was crazy enough to just say, the Holy Spirit said, you're lying. And they would lie and say, I don't have time for that. Because the difference between me and Ananias and Sapphira is we're under grace, and God won't strike you dead.
Amen.
But that don't mean you're not lying.
Because
Lord have mercy. I've seen people in this ministry come back and say, Pastor Smith, you said such and such. I didn't want to hear it at that time, but I'm ready now. I thank God for you being a man of God. And I'm okay because I don't get the glory. God gets it. I'm just telling you how I know that. When he says, and greater works shall you do, oh, he know what he's talking about. Because here's the other thing. I didn't ask Raquel to see your business.
Amen.
That's not what I'm in the business of doing, Alex. I like pastoring people. Listen, if I was having my way, everybody would leave out here with a good feel-good message every Saturday. God doesn't do us like that because he loves us.
Amen.
He's a good father. Greater works. Y'all ready? Greater works. How many of y'all ready to do greater?
Yeah.
Amen. Come on. Church. Sure, you know what? Please speak in faith. How many of y'all ready to do greater?
Yeah.
I love for it to get to the place where they say, everybody come out of New Bethel. Lord have mercy. They got a gift. They just anointed to do what they do. We looking for people who sick. Can you imagine if we go to the hospital and everybody on the seventh floor get healed? Come on, church, come on. We go to visit one of the members of New Bethel, but everybody say, I hear there's a man up here, you know, and people are being healed. There's a woman up here. People are being, that's what God wants, to get the glory. We so scared somebody gonna think we crazy. Well, the truth be told, I am. Crazy for Christ, yes. I would be mad at somebody if I found out they possessed what it was that I needed and didn't give it to me.
Yeah.
Lord have mercy. How many ready to make some decisions?
Amen.
You can give him power of attorney.
Yeah. Amen.
Oh, Lord, help me hurry up and get to this. This is 142. Please, God, help me to get it out.
He says here, now watch this. Do y'all believe this? Do y'all believe the word?
Yes.
Rose, people going to go home today and going to change the atmosphere in their homes when I give them this. Yep, Shane, their lives are going to change today. Shamika, you came at the right time. Do you hear me? Because what's getting ready to happen is, Mr. Rodney, stuff that you used to tolerate, you're going to recognize that after today's word, you don't have to tolerate that.
Amen.
Ain't nothing like walking up in a house and taking authority or something.
Amen.
And sometimes you don't have to say that. Sometimes you can just drive up and the demons know you there.
Amen.
God from Zion. Does anybody else know that that's the type of authority we've been given? You trying to figure out why you can't get along with everybody at work. It ain't that you did something wrong. Sometimes it's because you did something right. So busy trying to fit in, want everybody to like you. Everybody's not going to like you. What fellowship does light have with darkness? Watch this. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name. Now, I want to submit to you that word ask there, we might want to take a look, closer look at that in the Greek. And watch even what version of Strong's Exhaustive Concordance that you use, because what I'm getting ready to share with you, this is earlier on. I'm going to submit to you, unlike what Pastor Smith thought, this ain't necessarily talking about prayer. And the reason why I'm saying to you it ain't necessarily talking about prayer is because one of the definitions for ask in the text is demand.
Amen.
And I know we are never to demand anything from God.
Amen.
I don't know about y'all, but my kids don't demand nothing. They ask me.
Amen.
They don't demand nothing from dad. But who you do demand something from is the enemy.
Amen.
Talk deep. Yeah, how many of you are scared to take authority over what God has given to you? So watch this. If you have a spirit that's operating in your life, you have the right, you have the authority to demand that spirit to leave.
Amen.
I wish I had a church that didn't mind taking a trip with Jesus. Okay, some of y'all, you don't think I know what I'm talking about? And let me tell you what's funny, Selwyn, is the Holy Spirit is waiting on us to continue to speak out of our mouths what he told us to speak.
Amen.
Now, if we don't speak it, it's not God's fault.
Amen.
Because God gave it to us and told us what to do. We have got to make sure we don't fail to speak God's word.
Amen.
Elder, that's what I'm talking about. I wish I had a church that was ready to go. Y'all ready for some more word?
Amen.
And by the way, I'm only doing what Jesus did.
Amen.
He would see the people, he would teach him.
Yeah.
I challenge somebody to come and tell me what Jesus preached to him. Even though that's good, but he would teach him first. Because here's the thing, after you get an understanding, that's what activates your ability to be able to flow in the things of God.
Right.
Watch this
thing.
The other one that's on my mind, let's go to Matthew chapter 18. This is good. Somebody say good word.
Good word.
This is good, this is good. Somebody say good word, shout it out.
Good word.
Watch this. This is how I know, Kiana, he is waiting on us. Jesus is talking again. Y'all got this? Just one verse. Matthew 18, verse 18 says, and verily, here we go again with that verily. Listen, I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall. Okay, hold on. I know Elder Embry's got it. I know Shamika's got it. I know Elder Williams got it. I know Deacon Joe got it. I need to hear some more believers up in here with their Bibles. Give me some word back to Pastor, because see, y'all be the main ones calling me and ask me to pray about something when I'm trying to share with you. You already empowered to deal with that nonsense yourself.
Amen.
Please, y'all, I want to finish up, put my jacket back on and sit down. Can y'all go ahead and give me some word?
Amen.
So we're going to try this one more time. Verse 18, verily I say unto you, whatsoever, stop. What does whatsoever mean?
Everything.
I want to make sure church. What does whatsoever mean? Stop right there. Listen. All heaven is waiting for is for you to become in agreement with what God said. You know what that lady, Brother Glasson Smith, brought up here? You know what she said to me when she sat down there? She said, Pastor Smith, she said, I belong to Man of Bible Church. I said, oh, that's a blessing. Praise God. She said, but I also want you to know that I deal with arthritis in my body, and I deal with this, and I deal with that. I said, you mind if I pray for her? She said, no, I don't. I prayed for her, and I began to demand that arthritis take its hands off, its filthy, dirty hands off of God's vessel.
Yes.
You know what she told me? She said, thank you, Pastor Smith. She said, I don't claim none of it. They told me I had it, but I don't claim none of it. That's what I'm talking about.
Yes.
Why is it good? And we got people sitting up here. It blows my mind. It blows my mind. That's what I'm talking about, Pat. It blows my mind. And I want to say more, but I don't know that I could get it out without sounding like I'm mad at you. I'm really not. It blows my mind that you want to sit up in here like you got it all together. And some of us, you're just 2 seconds from losing your mind. You know where God brought you from, and you refuse to use the power that God has given to you. Good God from Zion. He's trying to tell you, woo, Lord have mercy. He's giving you power over all the works of the enemy. Here's the only, oh, this is good. Lord, am I teaching today, Holy Spirit? Here's the only thing, Elder, that can short-circuit that. Some people, Minister Tracy, are in love with the spirit that's been ruling their lives. You're so comfortable with it until you don't want to shake it, and you think that that's the only way for you to live. That ain't true. That's not true. That's not true. That's not true. That's not true. There's not one person in the Bible who repeated that God called, that he allowed any unclean spirit to linger around and live in their life.
Amen.
Either you're going to give God all of you, or he ain't taking part of you.
Amen.
He want all of you.
Oh.
He said, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Good God from Zion. Oh, he's waiting for you to activate. And then when he says here in the latter portion of that, he says, verse 18, and whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.
Amen.
And what better person than somebody who I can never stop telling that testimony. I grew up this way. Yeah. My mother and father, when something happened in my house, boy, we got the word.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I can already tell what's coming up, y'all.
When did that time we prayed together as a family?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Y'all in the same household, you can't come together and pray?
Yes, sir.
That's the equivalent of me talking all the time. And I never thought thinking about the third prayer.
There's something wrong. Oh, I say this much. You might tell me you represent God, but the fact of the matter is you really ain't representing God. Lord, we're right where we need to be. And you got nerve to keep coming in here. You think, this is why Pastor Smith don't move. I'm not moved by people running. I'm not even moved by God using certain people, because you know what? I know God loves us so much, he will use an unclean vessel if he wants to. Because he's God. So I'm not moved by none of that. You know what I look at? I look at your life. And here's what I'm saying. If you mean, if you bitter, if you nasty.
Yes, sir.
This is so good. Lord, I really wanted to stay up there and just share something good. But how many of y'all did? We've been given power of attorney.
Amen.
See, because Jesus also could do what Pastor Smith is doing. He could show up at a service, look injured, and say, you know what? You're lying. Come here. It's God's will that you be delivered today.
Amen.
Because see, watch this, watch. He could look at the person and know that we're not rebuking you. We're rebuking the spirit. What just happened? Praise the Lord. But watch it. It's the spirit. How many of y'all want to be free?
Yeah.
And you know, only you know what you're dealing with. How many of you want to be free? How many of you want to remain free? The only way for that to happen is for us to get in the face of God. Oh, let me share it with you like this. Just like stuff you're struggling with got transferred to you, let me tell you, the Holy Spirit can be transferred to you too.
Yeah.
You spend time with him, watch how he start transferring stuff to you. Watch how the old you start to just decrease and go away, subside if you will, but the new you start to get fresh and be renewed. Well, long as you stay connected to the Lord, but we got church members that don't want to do that. But Jesus said, whatever you bind. How many of us are binding? How many of us have taken a position and say, oh, this ain't going on in my house?
Amen.
I see a few. I see Raquel. I see Keon. I see a few. How many say, this ain't going on here? Oh, have mercy. That right there can't abide at 5116. I got to find a way to deal with it. God, I want to be loving, but we got to deal with that thing.
That's right.
What would it take every day of you get up and say, whatever it is they said you had, it don't live here? Let me. I'm telling you, it's activated. You got to. You have to, because that's what Jesus would do. He didn't just think about it. He said it. Okay, here's the difference. So when he says, whatever you ask in my name, there's a demand. Let me break it down for you. Satan,
take your filthy hands off of God's vessel. Because here's the thing. I don't see any exclamation points on it. And I really am careful about punctuation in the Bible because I've been to Bible class and I've read where certain places we inserted periods, God meant for the thought to continue because it can make a difference. And I don't have time to go through all the Bible to tell you everything that I know, but understand this much. When God is talking, I'm always listening to what he said and I'm taking it to heart. Because when he speaks, Nikita, he is a man that cannot lie. So he says, in greater work shall you do than here. It's expecting for us. Last time I checked, there were people who got healed under his ministry. There were people who were blind that all of a sudden started seeing. There are people who were lame who started walking. Oh, come on. Is there anybody else in here can believe to that degree where God... Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Ooh, we are agents. Thank you, Lord. Let me go back to John 14. Let me hurry up and do this. He says, in my name. Now listen, this is good. Let me get to that. Let me move past that real quick. Ooh, this is good. This is good. How many already make some decisions? We've been blessed to do the will of the Father. Yes, he raised the dead. He opened the blind people's eyes. He cast out demons. He cleansed lepers. He calmed the storms. He fed multitudes. Yes, yes, yes. And he expects for us to do more. Go to Acts 19 real quick. Acts 19. Hurry up, please. Hurry up. I know I took up the time. Hurry up. Y'all ready? Acts chapter 19 and verse 13. Somebody say good word. Then certain of the vagabond Jews, that's interesting within itself, exorcists took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches. And there were seven sons of one Sceva, a Jew, and chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you? And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them and overcame them and prevailed against them so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. And this was known to all the Jews and Greeks also dwelling in Ephesus, and fear fell on them all, and the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified. Well, let's break that down real quick. In 2015 language, the demons put a whooping on them. You know why the demons put a whooping on them? Because they wasn't authorized. Okay, see, as much as I like my name, don't try to cast out nothing in the name of Michael. Here's the other thing. I don't care how good you feel, you better know God told you to do something. Watch this. If you're going to come in anybody's name, you better come in the name of Jesus. Now, for everybody that want to argue about that, all I'm going to tell you is this. I've seen some powerful stuff done in the name of Jesus. And if that's wrong, let me go on record saying, I don't know that I want to be right. I didn't say I couldn't grow. We got some Bible scholars here that was going to come behind me. Praise the Lord. You're going to come say someone talk to me about sacred name. And I understand and say, and I'm not saying this because Bethel's with me. I would never be offensive to them like this. I'm saying it because this is where I pastor. And listen, there are things I've learned under Bishop S.P. Rollins. He said, I don't care how much growing you do, don't ever denounce the name of Jesus. Because I've seen some demons come out, Lord. I've seen them back up. And matter of fact, that's where we need to go. I have seen people come in one way and leave out another way because somebody said, in the name of Jesus. And what's funny is, what I said, even the demons. Now listen. What greater time for the enemy to show himself mighty than if what I'm saying is wrong? Because Satan is not in the business of building up God's kingdom. He's in the business of tearing it down. But he recognizes, Smith, every time that name come out your mouth, I don't have no power. Matter of fact, I am rendered powerless when y'all come in the name of Jesus. I could tell you some more stuff, but I'm going to stop right there just for that one. How many looking for some deliverance? Let me tell you something. The name of Jesus is what we was praying for when I was praying for your brother Jeremy.
Father right now. And listen, you don't have time to from everlasting to everlasting thou art God. You don't have time for all that. Sometimes stuff hits your door, in the name of Jesus. We're not taking that. That stuff, listen. One of the first times there was spiritual warfare started to break out in my house. Stuff started breaking and snapping. Garage doors started going up and down by themselves. And it hit me. I'll never forget this. I was driving a BMW and I backed out my garage and I looked and I said, God, what in the world is going on? As soon as I got that out of my mouth, Holy Spirit hit me. I said, in the name of Jesus, come subject. Almost like today when you have a good high service and then what starts happening is some spirits start getting stirred up. But I fought today. Thank you, Jesus, to stay focused. Lord, have mercy. Because before you know, you'll come out of yourself and be in the flesh. I said, the devil is a liar. We're coming to talk about the power of attorney. Authority's been transferred to us. Healing has been transferred to us. Anointing has been transferred to us. Certain things we don't have to take because of who our Heavenly Father is. Last time I checked, he whipped the enemy and brought him to an open shame. That's why New Bethelite members, you're covered under the blood of Jesus Christ. I don't care what comes to your door, you're covered in the blood of Jesus Christ. And for some of you who are still waiting for victory, let me tell you something, you better get ready for it because this is the season for it. This season, the enemy got to back up and take his hands off the things that God has ordained. Woo, I feel God today. Yes, Lord. Get ready for a season where the enemy starts to say, Paul, I know. Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. John, I know. Michael, I know. Veronica, I know. We ought not, Sister Geneva, be so passive. Oh, I just pray about, no. Let me tell you something. Somebody walk up in my house, Dave, and try to take one of my family members, ain't gonna be nothing passive about it. Come on, church. See, what, I hate to tell you this, but it's like Mother Tilly, we don't want it bad enough. I never forget the Sabbath. Your daughter was laid up here, pastor was working with her. Mother came from the back and began to say, take your hands off my child. That's what somebody who cares will do when they see somebody else they really care about. I wish, man. You know what? We are. Our church is interesting. We just want to. We want to see God, but we don't want to serve Him. It take people who want to be in the face of God. Have you ever thought about what it would be like, Geneva, to sit in the lap of God, where every single day you just want Him? You know you got to go to work because you got to live in this natural body, and there are things down here you still on earth, but you just want to be in the face of God. Lord, what more do you have for me? Look, anybody else who's just tired of coming to church and church as usual, but you want to see the move of God. You want to see the power of God. You want to see the glory of God. You want to see God glorified. You want to magnify God. You want to make Him large in the earth. Yes. Like something else I know right now, that's some of them spirits got stirred up. That's what should happen. God wants us to keep having this type of service until somebody go open the door. See, because just because you can't see it don't mean it ain't true. I need somebody else that's bold enough to decree and declare that anything that's not like God has got to vacate the premises. Because see, it's God's will that, listen, oh my God, Lord have mercy. You might have came in with vacancy on your chest today, but you're going to leave out occupied with the Holy Spirit. You're going to leave out occupied today. Somebody ought to declare in the spirit realm, there's no room for tenants. Yes, no dual occupancy. This place is occupied by the living God. Come on, somebody, you ought to declare it. Yes, you ought to make the devil mad and say, I belong to God. I'm covered under the blood of Jesus Christ, Yeshua the Messiah. That's right, Elder. Because if Abraham could pay tithes and his children be, and the grandchildren be covered, come on, somebody. How many of y'all know we can pray a prayer? My children, my children's children, my children's children, children's children will be covered. Yeah. It's 2:00. We're going to get y'all.
Mom, what time you got to leave today? We're gonna do this for you. She said, we fine. How many of y'all know I got a few more minutes on the clock? Oh, yes. D, before my children came here, I was walking my house praying for them. Before there were any kids in any of the rooms in my house, me and my wife would go through anointing and praying. Yeah, oh, yeah, we got to do that before they get here. Tell them who they are, Geneva, so when they get here, ain't nothing strange. Yes, indeed, you belong to the Lord. Walked up to pick up my son this week, and one of the teachers was there. She said, Mrs. Smith, she said, you got some sharp children. I said, well, praise the Lord. I said, I'm glad to hear that. She said, your son is a thinker. I said, I teach my children to think. I ask them questions like, why does that make sense to you? Had never been sitting there with a young lady. We're talking about Christmas and talking about it's a wonderful time for people to celebrate and whatnot. Another girl came up and said, well, I don't believe in God. Maybe there's some things that happen to cause her to be like that. Michael had a nice intellectual conversation with her and broke it down for her and said, well, let me tell you something. If you believe in evolution, you know and I know we ain't never seen no ape turn into a man. See, because if that really happened, at some point it ought to happen again. But since it ain't happening, and this is what blessed me, here's where he left her. He said, the same amount of faith it take you to believe in evolution. By the way, you ain't got no evidence and you ain't never seen nobody, no baboon turn into a man. It take the same amount of faith for you to believe in God. And until a baboon resurrects itself, until a baboon dies for me, I'm going to put my trust in. How many of y'all know he got what he wanted from his father that day? What you, Lord, have mercy. Am I the only one that got some blood-washed, spirit-filled, Bible-believing children? Every last one of us, Tracy, been given the power of attorney. The question becomes, what are we going to do with it? Because I know people with power been transferred to Diane, and they fail to use it. I've read about people who are millionaires, but because their thinking was messed up, and they didn't know what kind of authority had been given to them, they live on the street, they live like paupers. Whew. Just from an English perspective, how many of y'all know we ain't no vagabond Christians? Get ready. It's too over, Lord. Just we're gonna get out of here. Get ready. Elder, I love you, man. But we have declared war on every disease, every infection. I wish I had a church. You wanna attach yourself to a man of God? Tell somebody, I ain't talking about the song either. It sounds good, but I'm talking about living this thing. This means war. I mean, every time I think about it, I could be at work eating lunch, but I say, God, thank you for healing Elder Harris. I wish I had a church, Lord. I wish I had a church that did my blessing, God. And you don't have to touch him. I just wish you'd raise your hand and open that direction. God, thank God for healing. That's all. I mean, say it like you know it. So thank God for healing. Listen. The type of power that God has, Elder, is it can get to the place, D.D., where they can look and say, John, you don't even have a stomach no more. This is where, Lord help me, I got to move. This is where faith and the word comes in, Mom. This is what the Lord did with Ezekiel. He said, I want you to go over there, it's a little vision. He said, I want you to take a look. He said, I'm going to send you to the most ridiculous place. It's not just bodies over there. We're talking about bones. Now, the reason why he does that is because if you see bones, that suggests there's been deterioration. And it's not what it used to be. Now, God said, I'm going to show it to you because I want you to start speaking to it. Real quick, how many of y'all know if we fast forward, prophets start speaking, stuff start happening? How many of y'all know we can pull a new stomach out of heaven? We can pull a new digestive system out of heaven. Y'all not talking to no. I wish I had somebody believe. I don't want to gross you out, but just like that woman with an issue of blood, I don't know where she was bleeding from, but how many of y'all know when she met the main doctor? When she met a man named Jesus, whatever was flowing had to stop flowing. Whatever was infected had to get clean. Whatever was unholy became holy. Clap your hands and celebrate Jesus today. God, magnify him. Please stand. I'm going to let you get out of here. Ain't nothing like meeting people who were damaged and wounded. And I know God probably wants me to grow even more there because he continues to send me people like that. sends them here so they can get healed. And then he releases them to go on to do the work in the earth. How many of you want to see Jesus? Want to see that? When I say that, I want to see his move. Kiana, it just means that it's going to cost us something. But how many know it's well worth the price? Like you, Kiki, the times that I get a chance to grow closer to the Lord, remember just a little earlier in the ministry, the enemy would seek to use my children. Because I don't know about you all, but that's a quick distraction. Because I love my kids dearly. And it would pain me for me to go someplace people be blessed by the ministry, but my child still be that way. Anybody else know what I'm talking about? For those of you that don't, just make up in your mind this week, I'm going to live for God. And you start spending time with God. Spend more time with him than you do anything else at all. And then you watch where stuff starts to manifest in your life. The funny thing about God is that he is so confident in us until he whips the enemy, he kicks him out of heaven, and he puts him down here where God's kids are. And God says, I've empowered them. They're not going to trip up on me. I've empowered them. I beg of you, please, if you haven't, you giving yourself to the Lord would be the greatest gift you could ever give him. Please, accept Christ as your personal Savior. After doing that, find yourself a good church home. Sit under good preaching and good teaching. Apply it to your life. And watch it begin to experience the promised abundant life. Thank you so much again for fellowshipping with us. God bless you. Be encouraged and know this much. You ain't seen nothing yet. The best is yet to come.